So bear with me. I'm going to share a little bit of the story and read a few verses and then talk about it a little bit before I get to my final point. But I want to go in John chapter 11. We'll start in verse 55. I just want to pick up the last couple of verses here, and we'll go into John chapter 12. I'm going to skip through this to keep it as brief as possible, but we'll start out in verse 55 and read these last couple of verses of the book of John chapter 11. And I'm in the New Living Translation. It says, "And it was now almost time for the Jewish Passover celebration. And many people from all over the country arrived in Jerusalem several days early so they could go through the purification ceremony before Passover began. They kept looking for Jesus. But as they stood around in the temple, they said to each other, 'What do you think? He won't come for Passover, will he?' Meanwhile, the leading priests and Pharisees had publicly ordered that anyone seeing Jesus must report it immediately so they could arrest him." Jumping down into chapter 12, verse 12, it says, "The next day, the news that Jesus was on the way to Jerusalem swept through the city, and a large crowd of Passover visitors took palm branches and went down the road to meet him." This is what we celebrate as Palm Sunday. We have some palms here today. Typically, we would have palms for everybody to hand out and wave, but, you know, we're not passing stuff out right now. Amen. It says, it goes on to say, "They took the branches and went down the road to meet him. They shouted, 'Praise God!
Hallelujah!
Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hail to the King of Israel.' Jesus found a young donkey and rode on it, fulfilling the prophecy that said, 'Don't be afraid, people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming, riding on a donkey's colt.' His disciples didn't understand at the time that this was a fulfillment of prophecy, but after Jesus entered into his glory, they remembered what he had happened and realized that these things had been written about him. Many in the crowds had seen Jesus call Lazarus from the tomb, raising him from the dead, and they were telling others about it. That was the reason so many went out to meet him, because they had heard about this miraculous sign. Then the Pharisees said to each other, 'There's nothing we can do. Look, everyone has gone after him.'" Jumping down now to verse 37. Verse 37, as soon as I find it. Amen. It says, "But despite all the miraculous signs Jesus had done," now heading to my point of the day. "Despite all the miraculous signs Jesus had done, most of the people still did not believe in him." Jump down one more time to verse 42. It says, "Many people did believe on him, however, including some of the Jewish leaders, but they wouldn't admit it for the fear that the Pharisees would expel them from the synagogue." Listen to this last verse. "For they loved human praise more than the praise of God." My question for you on this Palm Sunday is, whose side are you on? As we look at the story, and I want to overview the story for you again just a little bit, Palm Sunday is referenced in all four Gospels. It represents the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. I do want you to understand that it's not his first time coming into Jerusalem. In fact, he had been in Jerusalem many times before that. His parents came nearly every year, the Bible says, because of the festivals that they had there. Most of the primary festivals of the Jewish people took place in Jerusalem. And so they would come from all over the countryside and all over other areas of the region to Jerusalem for these festivals. Passover was one of them. And also, Pentecost, which is 7 weeks from now, 8 weeks from today, actually, is another one. They would come different times to come in for these holy times of sacrifice and festivals and remembrance. Remember what we were just saying about repeating the stories. Each of these festivals was a remembrance of something that the Lord had done for them. And every year they were reminded of these events through the festivals. So they came to the city very frequently. Jesus was known to have come there, amen, for his blessing as a child after he was born. After the days of purification, they went to Jerusalem to the temple to have him blessed. When he was 12 years old, we see the story of him coming back, amen, right around the time of his becoming of age. And there he was in the synagogues, they said, talking and sharing with the teachers while his parents had lost him. You know that story. Amen. Amen. So he had frequently been in and out of Jerusalem. It was customary to travel there frequently for these festivals. But this particular time was unique. This particular time was different than any other. Jesus is now in the third year of his public ministry. He has been out now sharing and teaching and preaching, and also he has been healing and showing signs and miracles now for 3 years. Unlike in the past, he is now a very publicly recognized figure. He's recognized for his miracles. He is known by the Pharisees, who were the leaders of, in essence, the church, and also the leaders of the community of the people. They actually had governmental responsibilities under the Romans to make sure that the laws and everything and the peace was kept amongst their people. And so they were in power and authority, not only just religious leaders. They were responsible. So by this time, he's transitioned from an unrecognized and unknown person to a very well-known person and leader, and he's both loved and hated. He's a controversial figure. Many people don't know what to make out of him. Some of them look at him and they're excited about him. Some of them consider him to be a threat. Some of them consider him to be dangerous for various reasons. But he's evolved over these 3 years from what he used to be to a very different image as he is approaching Jerusalem at this point in time. Amen. So he had those that believed in him, and he had those that were threatened by him. By this time, in fact, he is seen as an enemy of the state by the religious leaders. And as you saw described in verse 57 of chapter 11, it said, anyone seeing Jesus must report him immediately so they could arrest him. They not only wanted to arrest him, they wanted him dead. They wanted him out of the picture. They were afraid of him. They were afraid of the power that he was drawing from the people. They were afraid that they were losing the influence that they had of the people. They were afraid because he was now beginning to say negative things about them. And so their positions were being threatened. On a broader perspective, they were afraid, amen, of the disruption that was happening in the community, in the city, and in the area around amongst the Jews. They were afraid that if they didn't do anything, that if it became a ruckus, if they were now celebrating him as a king, and they started rebelling against the Romans, that the Roman Empire would come in and destroy the entire city. If you go back and read further in chapter 11, you'll find the description of their conversations and how they're fearful of what might happen. In fact, it was said by Caiaphas, who was the chief priest at the time, he said, isn't it better for one man to die than all of the whole nation? Not realizing, the Bible says he didn't realize he was actually prophesying, amen, not intending to, that one man would die for the good of the whole nation. So they were afraid of him. And in some sense, they felt they were protecting the people, amen, by trying to do something about him. In other aspects, they were trying to protect themselves and their own power and their own position. So by this time, Jesus' position in ministry has changed. Earlier than this, I want you to understand, in the earlier part of his ministry, he had a little bit of a different approach to how he was approaching things. In the earlier parts of his ministry, you'll hear him telling people who he has healed, or people, amen, where demons have cast out. I said, don't tell them, amen, who healed you. Don't tell them how you were healed. Don't say anything about this when you go back home. In the first year, you find, amen, he kept things kind of quiet as time was going on. And people still went out excited and sharing it, amen, but it wasn't nearly as public, and he wasn't intending on making it as public then as he was now. You go down a little bit further and you find, amen, in the book of Mark, chapter 8. Amen. This, amen, Palm Sunday takes place in chapter 11 of the book of Mark. In chapter 8, prior to that, somewhere in the middle, he starts asking, and the Bible says he goes in and amongst the people, and he begins to ask his disciples, who do men say that I am? And so now the question, what's out there about me? What are people saying? What's the impression? As time is going on, he's beginning to reveal both his power, his wisdom, his words, and who he is, further and broader and more publicly. Now, by this time, before he enters in Jerusalem this time, he is fully known and recognized. In fact, the scripture tells us here that there are so many people, amen, that are drawn to this, because it was just prior to this time that he had spent time in Bethany with Mary and Martha. And you find where he spoke to Lazarus in the tomb, and Lazarus is risen from the tomb. Amen. So many witnesses, so many people that knew Lazarus to have been dead for 4 days. And now Jesus shows up and speaks, and he comes walking out of the tomb alive. This was a public thing, not done in the dark, not done at night, not done with nobody around. There were many, many people that saw it, and the word spread. And so as Jesus now is getting ready to come, amen, from Bethany into the city for Passover, amen, the people are spreading the word of this man. He is publicly known, publicly recognized, not only for what he did, but as an indication, a symbol of alignment with prophecy. You find at this time when he enters into this, he's not entering as somebody hiding. He doesn't come in the back door. He doesn't come in at nighttime, even though, amen, there's a warrant out for his arrest. He doesn't come in a shy fashion, but he comes in intentionally into the city. And as he's coming in, they're declaring him not only to be a great man, not only to be a prophet, but to be the king of the Jews. I want you to understand that at this time, Jesus intentionally sets this up. Why do we say that? Because when you look in the book of Mark, chapter 11, verse 1 and 2, you find the story there where he tells his disciples, go and find a young donkey. He says, go to that house. When you go down and around to that house, you're going to find a donkey. And when you take him, somebody's going to ask you what you're doing and tell them that the Lord has need of him and bring him to me. The scripture that we read earlier says, amen, this was a fulfillment of prophecy. And the prophecy comes from the book of Zechariah, chapter 9 and verse 9. Jesus here is fulfilling prophecy as he comes in. It says, amen, in what we read, amen, Jesus found a young donkey. I'm in 12, verse 14. And rode on it and fulfilled the prophecy that said, don't be afraid, people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming, riding on a donkey's colt. It's evident and obvious here that Jesus knew exactly what he was doing. He knew exactly what he was representing. Even though there was a threat, Jesus walked boldly in, amen, exactly as the Bible described he would show up. And in doing so, he establishes a conflict amongst those that follow him. Who's in the crowd and what do you believe? Whose side are you on? Are you on a side to truly believe, amen, that this really is the Son of God, this is the Messiah, this is our coming King that was prophesied, or do you not believe it? And the scripture describes to us that there was a mixed confusion in the midst of the crowd. Some weren't sure. Some, amen, followed because they saw what he did. Some were watching. Some were excited about what happened. There were some that truly believed, but there were many that did not. In verse 42 and 43, we read, it said, many people did believe in him, however, including some of the Jewish leaders. But they wouldn't admit it for fear that the Pharisees would expel them from the synagogue. For they love human praise more than they love the praise of God. So there were those in the crowd, amen, that believed and followed. There were those in the crowd that followed, the Bible says elsewhere, for the miracles. There were some that didn't believe, but they were still in the midst of the crowd. And so Jesus pushed this crowd into a corner to make them decide whose side you're going to be on. Are you a believer or are you not a believer? Amen. It's easy for us sometimes to sit comfortably in the midst and not make a decision. Anybody know what I'm talking about? There are times, amen, because there's so many people around you, you don't have to make a decision. You're just going along with the flow, just like the water and the current. The water, amen, just doesn't have to decide where it's going. The current takes it wherever it's going to go. But there comes a time when you have to make up your mind whose side you're on. I want you to understand today that everybody in the crowd is not necessarily on your side. Come on, somebody. Everybody that's around you, everybody that's hanging with you, everybody, amen, that's going places you're going is not necessarily on your side. Everybody does not believe the same thing that you believe. This crowd, amen, had smiles today. People around you will be smiling at you today, amen, and accolades today, amen, but crucify you tomorrow. You've got to understand some things about the crowd, amen. The crowd is not always right, and you can't always depend on what the crowd does to decide what you're going to do. Sooner or later, you have to make up your mind for yourself what you believe. The question to you today is, whose side are you on? Right, you got to know it for yourself. You got to know what's right. Amen. You can't just trust, amen, just because somebody's around you, amen, that they're doing, amen, what they should be doing and you should be doing what they're doing. You can't just depend, amen, that what everybody else is saying is the right thing to say. Listen, just because, amen, you're in a large crowd, amen, just because you're in a church with thousands of people around you instead of tens of people around you doesn't necessarily make it right. You've got to know for yourself who Jesus is. Come on, somebody say hallelujah. Whose side are you on today? Jesus wants to know. Jesus is asking you today, whose side are you on? If you were standing in that crowd today, Palm Sunday, amen, and Jesus comes walking down, it's easy to watch those that are waving. It's easy to watch those that are making a bunch of noise. But whose side are you on? Do you truly believe that Jesus is the Son of God? Amen. Or are you just following the crowd? Do you truly believe that he is your Lord and Savior? Or are you just doing what others told you to do? Amen. Are you just following tradition? Or do you know Christ for yourself? Hallelujah. Just because you're in church, listen, just because you're in church does not make you godly. Come on. Amen. Just because you like Christian music, amen, does not make you holy. Amen. You can be around the church but not be the church. Sooner or later, you're going to have to decide for yourself who you are. Amen. And oftentimes to follow Jesus, you really have to step outside of the crowd. Amen, because the crowd is going to do what the crowd is going to do. Amen, many times the crowd will shift and will swirl and will go wherever the winds take them. But to really follow Jesus, amen, oftentimes you're not in the middle of the crowd. Most of the people in the Bible who truly followed him stepped out of the crowd to do it. Moses had to step out of the crowd to go up into the mountain. David couldn't praise the Lord like everybody else did. He had to praise him, amen, until his clothes fell off. Amen. You've got to decide for yourself, if I truly love God, it's not a matter whether everybody else is clapping or everybody else is singing. I'm praising him because of what's going on down on the inside of me. Hallelujah. To follow him, amen. You've got to decide, amen, amen, what you truly believe. The crowd crucified him. It was individuals that stood by the cross, amen, when he was dying. The crowd was the one that cried out, crucify him. Are you following, amen, because of your parents? Are you following because of your friends? Are you following, amen, your traditions? Or are you truly following Jesus today? Whose side are you on? Heard Joshua in the book, amen, of Joshua chapter 24 and 15 say, choose ye this day whom ye will serve. He was talking to the crowd in the midst of all of you people, all of the people, amen, of Israel. Amen. Listen, you're a crowd of people. We're one people, but every one of you has a decision that you have to make for yourself. You can't do it because your friends do it. You can't do it because your family did it. You can't get saved, amen, because of those around you. You will never get saved by a crowd. You'll only get saved by calling on the one and only Savior, and his name is Jesus Christ. Choose ye this day whom you will serve. He asked them whether it's going to be the gods of your fathers, Amen. Or whether it's going to be the gods of the Amorites. In other words, the gods of your friends. He's asking them, who are you going to serve? Amen. Are you going to serve the gods of your friends? Are you going to serve the gods of your fathers? Or are you going to serve the true and living God? Whose side are you on today? Here's the word that he went on to say. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I don't know what you're going to do. I don't know what's in store for you. I don't know what direction you're going to go. I don't know what decision you're going to make. But regardless of family, regardless of friends, regardless of what anybody else does, I don't care if no one else will praise. I don't care if anybody else doesn't realize it. This day I recognize that my Lord and Savior came all the way from heaven down to give his life for me. And if nobody else has a praise for him, I will lift him up with the top of my voice. I will give God the praise. Hosanna to the King. Hosanna to the King. As for me and my house, we will praise the Lord. Amen. Who believes, amen, in the Lord and Savior today? Come on, if you believe in him, stand up and give God a praise that he deserves. This is the Lord's day. This is the Lord's time. This is the Lord's hour. And we give God the praise. Come on, choose for yourself. If you'll praise him, lift him up right now. Don't wait for anybody else. Don't wait for whoever's around you. Give God the glory he deserves today. Hallelujah. As for me and my house, I don't need a crowd to praise him. I don't need hundreds to praise him. I don't need somebody to join with me. I've got a praise of my own for him, and I'll give him the glory that he deserves today. Whose side are you on today? If you're on the Lord's side, come on and shout glory to the Lord. Hallelujah. We give the Lord the praise. We give God the praise he deserves today. Hallelujah, hallelujah. If it had not been for the Lord on our side today, if he had not gone into the city, if he had turned around and went away, if he had decided to live for himself instead of living for us, we would not have a hope. But today we glorify him because he's been good to us, better to us than we could be to ourselves. I don't know about you, but I've got a praise for the Lord today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I've got a shout for the Lord today, because he's worthy of it. This day we glorify him. This day we praise him. This day we rejoice. Hallelujah. For he has made me glad. Hallelujah. He has made me glad. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Hosanna to the Lord. Hosanna to the King of Kings. Hosanna to the Lord of Lords. Hosanna to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the one and only. Nobody could do it but him. I'm so glad he did it. Hallelujah. He didn't have to do it, but I'm so glad he did. Hallelujah. Hosanna, hosanna. Glory to the name of the Lord. Praise God today. Praise God today. This is a day to rejoice. This is a day to praise him for what he's done for us today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Today I have no hesitation. Today I have no question. Today I don't have to wonder. I don't have to consider. I know for myself, hallelujah, that he's worthy of our praise. Hallelujah. I know for myself, hallelujah, hallelujah, he deserves our praise. I know for myself he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Who do you say he is? I say he's Jesus, hallelujah, the Son of Nazareth and the Son of God. I say he's Jesus, the only one that can save us from our sins. I say he's Jesus that came from heaven, that died and rose again. I say he's Jesus, the Savior of my soul. I say he's Jesus, the one Lord, the one faith and the one baptism. Jesus Christ, the one and only, hallelujah. Some call him, hallelujah, a wise man. Some call him, hallelujah, a prophet. Some call him a good man with good words. But I know him as more than that. I know him as Savior of the world. I know him as the Son of God. I know him as the one who changes a life, hallelujah, who turns lives around, hallelujah, who gives us fresh starts. I know him as the one that revives my spirit and revives my soul, that makes all things new again. Jesus, hallelujah. Son of the living God, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Whose side are you on today? Whose side are you on today? Whose side are you on today?